Penguin Audio presents Shades of Grey by Jasper Fforde, read by John Lee. A Morning in Vermilion. 2.4.16.55.021. Males are to wear dress code number 6 during inter-collective travel. Hats are encouraged, but not mandatory. It began with my father not wanting to see the last rabbit, and ended up with my being eaten by a carnivorous plant. It wasn't really what I'd planned for myself. I'd hoped to marry into the Oxbloods and join their dynastic string empire. But that was 4 years ago, before I met Jane, retrieved the Caravaggio, and explored High Saffron. So instead of enjoying aspirations of chromatic advancement, I was wholly immersed within the digestive soup of a Yataveo tree. It was all frightfully inconvenient. But it wasn't all bad, for the following reasons. First, I was lucky to have landed upside down. I would drown in under a minute, which is far, far preferable to being dissolved alive over the space of a few weeks. Second, and more important, I wasn't going to die ignorant. I had discovered something that no amount of merits can buy you. The truth. Not the whole truth, but a pretty big part of it. And that was why this was all frightfully inconvenient. I wouldn't get to do anything with it, and this truth was too big and too terrible to ignore. Still, at least I'd held it in my hands for a full hour and understood what it meant. I didn't set out to discover a truth. I was actually sent to the outer fringes to conduct a chair census and learn some humility. But the truth inevitably found me, as important truths often do, like a lost thought in need of a mind. I found Jane, too, or perhaps she found me. It doesn't really matter. We found each other. And although she was grey and I was red, we shared a common thirst for justice that transcended chromatic politics. I loved her, and what's more, I was beginning to think that she loved me. After all, she did apologize before she pushed me into the leafless expanse below the spread of the Yataveo, and she wouldn't have done that if she'd felt nothing. So that's why we're back here. 4 days earlier, in the town of Vermilion, the regional hub of Red Sector West. My father and I had arrived by train the day before and overnighted at the Green Dragon. We had attended morning chant and were now seated for breakfast, disheartened but not surprised that the early greys had already taken the bacon and it remained only in exquisite odour. We had a few hours before our train and had decided to squeeze in some sightseeing. "We could always go and see the last rabbit," I suggested. "I'm told it's unmissable." But Dad was not to be easily swayed by the rabbit's uniqueness. He said we'd never see the badly drawn map, the Oz Memorial, the colour garden, and the rabbit before our train departed. He also pointed out that not only did Vermilion's museum have the best collection of Vimto bottles anywhere in the collective, but on Mondays and Thursdays they demonstrated a gramophone. "A 14-second clip of Something Got Me Started," he said, as if something vaguely red-related would swing it. But I wasn't quite ready to concede my choice. "The rabbit's getting pretty old," I persisted, having read the safety briefing in the How Best to Enjoy Your Rabbit Experience leaflet, "and petting is no longer mandatory." "It's not the petting," said Dad with a shudder, "it's the ears." "In any event," he continued with an air of finality, "I can have a productive and fulfilling life, having never seen a rabbit." This was true, and so could I. It was just that I'd promised my best friend, Fenton, and 5 others that I would log the Lonely Bun's taxa number on their behalf, and thus allow them to note it as proxy seen in their animal spotter books. I'd even charged them 25 cents each for the privilege, then blew the lot on licorice for Constance and a new pair of synthetic red shoelaces for me. Dad and I bartered like this for a while, and he eventually agreed to visit all of the town's attractions, but in a circular manner, to save on shoe leather. The rabbit came last, after the colour garden. So, having conceded to at least include the rabbit in the morning's entertainment, Dad returned to his toast, tea, and copy of Spectrum as I looked idly about the shabby breakfast room, seeking inspiration for the postcard I was writing. The Green Dragon dated from before the Epiphany, and, like much of the collective, had seen many moments, each of them slightly more time-worn than the one before. The paint in the room was peeling, the plaster moulding was dry and crumbly, the linoleum tabletops were worn to the canvas, and the cutlery was either bent, broken, or missing. But the hot smell of toast, coffee, and bacon, the flippant affability of the staff, and the noisy chatter of strangers enjoying the transient acquaintance gave the establishment a peculiar charm that the reserved, eminently respectable tea rooms back home in Jade under Lime could never match. I noticed also that despite the lack of any rules regarding seat plans in non-hue-specific venues, the guests had unconsciously divided the room along strictly chromatic lines. The one ultraviolet was respectfully given a table all to himself, and several greys stood at the door waiting patiently for an empty table even though there were places available. We were sharing our table with a green couple. They were of mature years and wealthy enough to wear artificially green clothes so that all could witness their enthusiastic devotion to their hue, a proudly expensive and tastelessly ostentatious display that was doubtless financed by the sale of their child allocation. Our clothes were dyed in a conventional shade, visible only to other reds. So, to the greens, sitting opposite, we had only our red spots to set us apart from the greys, and were equally despised. When they say red and green are complementary, it doesn't mean we like each other. In fact, the only thing that reds and greens can truly agree on is that we dislike yellows more. "You," said the green woman, pointing her spoon at me in an exceptionally rude manner. "Fetch me some marmalade." I dutifully complied. The green woman's bossy attitude was not atypical. We were three notches lower in the chromatic scale, which officially meant we were subservient. But although lower in the order, we were still prime within the long-established red-yellow-blue color model, and a red would always have a place in the village council, something the greens, with their bastard blue-yellow status, could never do. It irritated them wonderfully. Unlike the dopey oranges, who accepted their lot with a cheery, self-effacing good humor, greens never managed to rise above the feeling that no one took them seriously enough. The reason for this was simple. They had the color of the natural world almost exclusively to themselves, and felt that the scope of their sight gift should reflect their importance within the collective. Only the blues could even begin to compete with this uneven share of the spectrum, as they owned the sky. But this was a claim based mainly on surface area rather than a variety of shades, and when it was overcast, they didn't even have that. But if I thought she was ordering me about solely due to my hue, I was mistaken. I was wearing a needs humility badge below my red spot. It's related to an incident with the head prefect's son, and I was compelled to wear it for a week. If the green woman had been more reasonable, she would have excused me the errand due to the prestigious 1,000 merits badge that I also wore. Perhaps she didn't care. Perhaps she just wanted the marmalade. I fetched the jar from the sideboard, gave it to the green, nodded respectfully, then returned to the postcard I was writing. It was of Vermilion's old stone bridge, and had been given a light blue wash in the sky for 5 cents extra. I could have paid 10 and had one with greened grass, too, but this was for my potential fiancée, Constance Oxblood, and she considered over-colorization somewhat vulgar. The oxbloods were strictly old color and preferred muted tones of paint wherever possible, even though they could have afforded to decorate their house to the highest chroma. Actually, much to them was vulgar, and that included the russets, whom they regarded as nouveau couleur, hence my status as potential fiancé. Dad had negotiated what we called a half promise, which meant I was first optioned to Constance. The agreement fell short of being reciprocal, but it was a good deal. A concession that, despite being a russet and three generations from grey, I might be able to see a goodly amount of red, so couldn't be ignored completely. "Writing to Fishface already?" asked my father with a smile. "Her memory's not that bad." "True," I conceded, "but despite her name, constancy is possibly her least well-defined attribute." "Ah, Roger Maroon still sniffing about. As flies to stinkwort, and you mustn't call her Fishface." "More butter," remarked the green woman, "and don't dawdle this time." We finished breakfast and, after some last-minute packing, descended to the reception desk, where Dad instructed the porter to have our suitcases delivered to the station. "Beautiful day," said the manager as we paid the bill.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.